Late spring in Pennsylvania can sometimes be difficult to predict. This April was unusually rainy and warm. Usually, I would have to mow my lawn for the first time in early to mid-May or so, but not this year. At least it's not snowing. This time last year, we had a snowstorm that dropped 15 centimeters on the area. I think having to mow the lawn early is worth being thankful for the lack of snow. And with tax season over, it was nice to get outside into the sunshine. My house has an interesting feature. The backyard slopes heavily downward, leading to a small stream and woods behind us. When they built the house, they used backfill to level the front of the house with the road. This meant a steep slope, about halfway up the side of the house. Thus, the basement, completely closed at the front, ended up at the back. This allowed me to install a double-leaf service door, so I would drag my lawnmower and other lawn supplies in there instead of cluttering up the garage. This was one of my favorite features of the house. I'm done with the mower, and everything is in place. I'm allergic to grass, so I couldn't wait to go upstairs and shower. I had almost reached the top step when I heard my wife's voice. While I was mowing in front of the house, I saw her friend's car, so I wasn't surprised to hear voices. But then I heard what was being said, and it made my hand pause as I reached for the doorknob. I think I should start by introducing myself. My name is Robert Crane. I prefer to be called Bob, but in school they called me Hogan, after the actor Robert Crane, who starred in Hogan's Heroes. I didn't mind, but the show aired before I was born, and it doesn't count as a pop culture reference anymore. When I graduated from the University of Pennsylvania with a degree in accounting, I was still called Hogan. After graduating, I earned my CPA degree in the shortest amount of time required, and am currently working for a large firm in Philadelphia as a team leader doing audits and the like. It's not the most exciting position, but it pays very well, and I've been able to see the inner workings of many companies. I have a special gift for forensic analytics, building financial trails to investigate things like fraud and money laundering. I am considered an expert, and was even asked to advise the FBI on two cases. My wife, Kelly, was a political science and business major planning to pursue a law degree when we met early in our freshman year. I was sitting waiting for the first day of classes when she walked in. Kelly had a tall, slender figure, like a ballerina, only with slightly larger breasts. Her long strawberry blonde hair flowing loosely over her bare shoulders was a beautiful sight. She wore a beautiful sundress, with sandals, that emphasized her amazing legs, smooth and elastic. The mixture of innocence and sexuality was too strong. I was overcome with instant lust. Unfortunately, Kelly wasn't sitting next to me, and she was not assigned to my group project. It took me 4 weeks to approach her and break the ice. I made a stupid joke and she laughed. It wasn't a graceful giggle, but a full-blown laugh. We started talking and I asked her if she wanted to have coffee after class. "I've been waiting for your question for 4 weeks," she smiled in response. The last 2 years of college, we were rarely apart. Our parents weren't too happy, but during our senior year, we moved in together. But they saw how devoted we were to each other, and soon came to terms with it. I couldn't imagine how things could get even better. But that's what happened. I graduated from university and immediately took a job at one of the large accounting firms in Philadelphia. I was making a stupid amount of money for a recently graduated 22-year-old. Kelly was accepted into the University of Pennsylvania Law School, and we stayed in our student apartment. My company offered to pay for my MBA degree, so I took classes too. I rode SEPTA to work every day, so I didn't need a car, and it cut down on costs. 3 years later, Kelly graduated from university, and I proposed to her during a birthday dinner at Morton's Steakhouse in Rittenhouse Square. 6 months later, we got married. Kelly accepted a position as a deputy district attorney in the Bucks County District Attorney's Office, which is north of Philadelphia. We decided to buy a house in Doylestown, which was the county seat and had a courthouse. The regional rail line also ended there, so I could take the train to work every day. It was an 80-minute drive one way, but it was better than driving on the Schuylkill Expressway or I-95. Kelly and her mother found a home. It was a great starter home with 3 bedrooms. One bedroom was equipped as an office with 2 desks. I will sometimes work from home, and Kelly needed her own space for her legal work. The other bedroom will be the guest room, and of course, the last room will be our master bedroom. It was also close to her parents' house. Kelly convinced me that this was a built-in nanny option once we had kids. I was an only child and always wanted to have brothers and sisters. Kelly and I had talked about having kids since freshman year and agreed to wait until Kelly was settled in her career before we started trying. But now we've reached this point, and 2 nights ago, we agreed to stop taking Kelly's birth control and start trying for a baby. I was happier than ever before, and then I heard something that made my hand linger on the doorknob. Hogan and I decided it was time for me to get pregnant, Kelly announced excitedly. This delighted her friend, Olivia Watkins. Both women made the same high-frequency noise that made me think of whales accidentally beaching themselves off the Jersey shore in an attempt to get to him. Standing on the stairs, I grinned at their excitement, which matched my own at becoming a father. Reaching for the pen again, I heard a question that wiped the grin off my face and the happiness right out of me. "This is wonderful, Kel," said Olivia. "But what are you going to do with Paul?" "The floor? Shh." Kelly calmed her friend down. "Hogan is outside mowing the lawn." There was a pause, and I could almost see her looking around, waiting for me to appear. Then she spoke again. "I already told Paul that I'm ending the affair." He didn't mind. After Grossman steps down as senator, Paul thinks he has a real chance. Getting caught having an affair with a married employee would be very unpleasant. It's that simple. 3 sentences destroyed my world. Paul Evans was Kelly's boss in the DA's office. He was a widower, about 40 years old. His wife Anne died of breast cancer, leaving him a single father to their daughter, Barbara. Paul was a true political animal, and Kelly told me stories about his maneuvering within his party to run for higher office. Looks like I just found out how my wife got access to all this secret information. "Is it true?" Olivia said. "Just cold turkey? You've been hot and serious for 6 months, and now you're just going to give it up?" The teasing doubt in her voice made me want to rip Olivia's head off. She was a classmate at Penn State, and I knew her before Kelly. I knew Kelly and Olivia were best friends now, but I always thought she was still my friend. Looks like I was wrong about this. "Stop it!" Kelly protested, giggling. "You're so bad. Paul is a great lover, but he was just rough to play with. I love Hogan, but Paul just took me and used me the way he wanted. There was no love, only rough sex and power. Now that Bob and I are going to have a baby, I don't want to take any chances. I love Hogan and will be a good and faithful mother." How many more cliches are we going to have here? I asked myself a question. All I still need to be completely happy is to come home, find an unfamiliar car in the driveway, and discover that they are having sex in my bed. I wanted to run into the room and scream, destroy the room, but my muscles were paralyzed. I was so stunned that I couldn't move. My heart was beating in my ears. "So, cold turkey?" Olivia asked, and again Kelly's giggle. "Well, not cold turkey," she admitted. "Next week I have a conference with Paul in Pittsburgh. We'll have our farewell party there. I'll miss the sex, but Hogan and the baby are more important. I couldn't stand it anymore, but I didn't know what to do. I love Kelly, but this was killing me. My business education began to make itself felt. I needed to step back and think, and I needed to make a plan. I started stomping up the steps as if I was climbing stairs. Then I opened the door and entered the kitchen. Kelly and Olivia sat there with cups of tea in front of them. Was this a hint of guilt that I saw on Kelly's face? Honey, are you okay? She asked worriedly. Then I realized that my cheeks were covered with tears. Allergies, I muttered. It will be a bad spring. Well, go upstairs and take a shower. Just throw these clothes near the bathroom and I'll wash them right away so they don't mess up your closet. Last week I bought you a new package of Claritin D, which is in the medicine cabinet. Thank you, I managed to say, heading towards the stairs. I needed time to think. The next morning was Monday, and I used the excuse of an early meeting to get up and out of the house before Kelly got out of bed. The night before, I used my allergies as a reason to go to bed early because my emotions were on edge. Sitting in the carriage, I thought again about what I had heard. On the one hand, my wife was unfaithful, but it all ended purely sexually, in order to stay with me and give birth to my child. Some would say that I should leave things as they are and be happy that my wife is returning to marriage with plans to be a good wife and mother. However, there is a voice in my head that says that if she did it once, what will stop her from doing it again in the future? 10 years from now, when the kids go to school, will she have another just sexy affair? Then divorce with children, where Kelly will most likely get the children and I will get a big bill for child support and child support. As an accountant and business analyst, I thought in terms of risk and reward, I find myself doing the same thing here. It got to the point where my trust in my wife was completely destroyed. The just sex excuse misses what is the truly important issue in such cases. This is a complete lack of respect for your partner. The cheater knows that what they are doing is wrong and that they are hurting the other person. Otherwise, they would have done it openly, and I would have known about it from the very beginning. Don't get me wrong. I don't think I would ever come to terms with her sleeping with Paul, but at least if she talked to me about it, there would be some respect shown. Kelly's action showed me how much she truly respects me. I was working, but part of my brain was focused on what I should be doing. I had no evidence other than the overheard conversation. I didn't even notice anything different during the last 6 months during which this affair apparently continued. Direct confrontation without evidence would be a high risk with little chance of reward. Kelly will deny it. Paul Evans will deny. Taking any case through the courts would have been financial suicide, since every judge, politician, and lawyer in the surrounding counties knew Evans. I would have been buried to keep his name clear. I thought about just leaving and starting over somewhere else. It was tempting, but the house would be like an anchor around my neck. Kelly couldn't afford it on her salary alone, and we had almost no equity. She would have to sell it almost immediately to avoid foreclosure, and in today's market, that was unlikely. It would ruin both my credit reputation and hers. Being a CPA with a bad credit history is not the best decision when looking for a new position. How can anyone trust you with other people's money if you clearly don't know how to handle your own? I needed proof before I could do anything. I would have had them, but they came from the most unlikely source. 3 days later, I kept myself under control, but still had not found any evidence to support what I had heard. Her personal laptop was clean. No secret email accounts were discovered. No sexy lingerie hidden in a box in the back of the closet. No receipts from places she shouldn't have gone. Absolutely nothing. Then Kelly called me at work and said we were invited to a political announcement party at Paul Evans's house on Friday night. I assumed this would be his big announcement of his candidacy for a seat in the U.S. Senate. I had thoughts of a big reveal, but I still had no proof, damn it. We arrived just in time for the big event. Evans had a large mansion near Washington Crossing with a small horse farm. In the backyard, a large tent was erected for all the guests, and when we walked in, there stood the asshole himself, Paul Evans, at the head of the reception line like he was a king. As a widower, Evans did not have a wife to play hostess to, but he clearly recruited his 21-year-old daughter for the role. She stood next to her father, greeting guests as if she had been born to do so. When it was our turn, Evans smiled broadly at Kelly and exclaimed, "Kelly, you did it! How wonderful!" He kissed my wife chastely on the cheek. Then he turned to me. "Robert, I'm glad to see you again. I would be lost without your wife, but, as I understand it, I will soon have to give her up when you start expanding your family." He laughed at his own joke. "Just let me take her when you're done with her, and there won't be any hard feelings." Laughter again. Kelly even blushed a little, and I wanted to kill this grinning fool. I understood his hint, which apparently, in his opinion, went over my head. "Who knows what the future will bring," I said, in a flat, neutral tone. Not hostile, but by no means friendly, I reported the audit results in the same way. Evans blushed slightly, and Kelly elbowed me and muttered something about being rude. Evans smoothly turned to the next guest, leaving us alone with his daughter. Kelly was an incredibly attractive woman, but Barbara Evans was a vision. Even in my inner rage, I noticed this. Her auburn hair and brilliant smile made me think of a young Maureen O'Hara. If Kelly looked like a busty ballerina, Barbara looked like she belonged on a swimsuit pin-up calendar. next to Kate Upton. She had the combination of good looks, healthy figure, hair and skin that photographers dreamed of and often had to use Photoshop to achieve. Paul Evans had the perfect political family with a triple threat. He seemed ideal for the role of wise statesman and family man. Losing his wife to cancer provided him with the ideal wife. She was idolized, and any opponent who attacked her was prepared to commit career suicide. Barbara was a princess, prom queen, Penn State business and law major, former gymnast, and now Penn State cheerleader. According to Kelly, Barbara was planning to try out for the Eagles cheerleading squad at the next open competition since she had just turned 21. With a saintly late wife and a smart, beautiful, photogenic daughter, the press will love him on the campaign trail. "Robert," Barbara said in an excited tone, hugging me tightly. This was not a polite hug at a party. It was a full body compression. Parts of her body pressed against me in the most pleasant manner. "You look great. No wonder Kelly hid you away. You never come to any of our parties. You shouldn't work so hard. It's bad for your health." Somehow, she got it all out in one breath. In less than a second, my mood changed from rage to complete shock. I said a few polite words about how beautiful she looked and was about to leave when two thoughts occurred to me. First of all, Barbara never greeted Kelly. And secondly, what kind of parties? Kelly didn't give me a chance to ask as she rushed with her own greeting to the young woman. Then we had no choice but to give way to the next guests in line. When Kelly and I went to hang out, I wondered what Barbara knew. After pouring my wife a drink, I asked, "What parties was Barbara talking about?" Kelly just smiled and snorted dismissively. "She was just teasing, little brat. Paul sometimes holds team meetings and strategy meetings here. He says he thinks better with a drink in his hand, and at a bar you never know who might be in the next booth. She was home several times when we met here. Don't tell anyone, but Paul allowed her to drink at home before she turned 21. Well, that got me thinking. This bastard had sex with my wife right here in his home under the guise of team meetings. These could even be actual meetings that Kelly was the last to leave, or perhaps she left first and came back after everyone else had left. This would prevent the legal team from speculating about why Kelly always stayed behind to help her boss clean up the mess. With his wife dead and his daughter away at college, he didn't need to find a secluded hotel room. Therefore, there is no record of their meeting." "So Barbara attends your team meetings?" I asked. Kelly brushed off the question. "No, she was at home several times when her classes were canceled. She's just teasing her dad about partying during work hours." She pulled my hand. "Come on, honey, buy your young wife a drink." For the next hour, Kelly never left my side. We talked to a few of her coworkers, and several people brought up our plans to have a baby and how sad they would be to lose Kelly for a while, but how happy they were for us. To be honest, I was a little embarrassed. Why did all these people know about our plans? An hour later, Paul Evans called everyone to attention. His daughter stood smiling next to him. He started by thanking everyone for coming and then began by announcing his big campaign. Everyone expected this, but they were still excited. I noticed the local newspaper publisher with one of his reporters nearby, taking notes. "I have no doubt that there will be a big article about this in tomorrow's newspaper. I won't bore you with the rest of the party details. It would have been a pleasant time if my heart hadn't been shattered and my brain hadn't been working on overdrive thinking how to prove it all." About an hour and a half after the grand announcement, Margaret Williamson, the first assistant district attorney, came in and said that Paul wanted to meet with his staff. While Paul was an elected official, Margaret was a senior manager who essentially ran the office. Prosecutors might come and go every 4 years, but Margaret was a constant. She was a very tough woman, but at the same time, very respected for her honesty and integrity in the legal community. The older woman lawyer was the main reason Kelly took the position. I really liked her. Margaret had been married for over 30 years to an electrician who had put her through college and now owned a large electrical contracting company. The two were devoted to each other. I always thought of them as role models for Kelly and me. "Sorry for stealing your wife, Hogan," Margaret offered. Paul wants to discuss the organization of the office when he stops campaigning. A moment later, they both left. I walked away from the small gathering of other spouses remaining at the meeting and headed to the other side of the large pool located across from the patio where the party was taking place. There was a wicker swing chair hanging on chains. It was in the shadows, so people could see me if they looked, but I wouldn't be conspicuous. In other words, it was the perfect place for me to try to collect my thoughts. Not having sat there for even 5 minutes, a voice invaded my solitude. "So this is where you're hiding," the voice purred. I looked up as Barbara slid into the wicker swing next to me. She positioned herself so that she was sitting facing me without saying a word. Her little black dress sat on her tanned hips so that it hugged her body, hinting at what lay underneath, without revealing anything. Seductive and innocent at the same time. It speaks volumes about my state of mind that I noted this almost academically. "You look like a person who has the weight of the world on his shoulders," she commented. I didn't really want to talk about this with my wife's lover's daughter, no matter how sexy she was. "We were very busy in the office. There are a lot of audits going on," I said to end the conversation.
"Is it true?"
Barbara asked interestedly. "I just finished my last accounting course at university. We taught several classes about the use of forensic accounting in law enforcement. I thought it was very exciting. Even in my grief, this surprised me."
"Is it true?" I asked incredulously.
"Well, it's not sexy or anything, but it really is a detective's job to gather all the right pieces of information from a ton of other facts and put them together to get a clear picture. Plus, since some people try to hide this information, it becomes even more difficult."
"Most people don't think so," I admitted.
Barbara began to talk in detail about what she had learned in the class and why she enjoyed it so much. I must say that I was impressed. I've had people finishing their internships at firms who couldn't speak so well on this topic. Focusing on her words really helped me push aside both her appearance and, more importantly, the anger that was simmering deep inside me. I felt immersed in the role of mentor. This helped me push the emotional turmoil a little into the background.
"You really liked the course," I remarked. "It looks like you have mastered the topic very well."
Barbara blushed at my praise. For a moment, the pinup girl disappeared, and I saw a sweet girl, genuinely touched by my simple praise. "I really thought about joining the FBI when I finished school. Dad wants me to either become a prosecutor or go work for one of his friend's law firms. I don't think this is what I want to do."
"You should follow your own dreams, not your father's dreams."
That was honest advice, not that I was against ruining that freak's plans. "I worked a little with the FBI when audits revealed something criminal. Sharp people." Before Barbara could respond, Kelly stepped out of the shadows.
"That's where you disappeared too. You didn't do anything indecent?" she asked teasingly.
Barbara turned to face my wife with a beaming smile.
"We were just talking about Bob's work. We were just discussing this in class. I wanted to get an expert's opinion."
"Well, Hogan is like that," Kelly said proudly. "I looked at one of his audit reports where an employee embezzled money using his boss's login. Hogan realized that some of the transfers occurred while the guy was on a business trip, but the login was done from the corporate office. Most of us would have stopped when the boss was identified." Hogan continued to dig. "I could have gotten a conviction against this employee the first day out of law school. Hogan left prosecutors with nothing to do in the case." Kelly looked at me with pride on her face as she told this little story. This confused the hell out of me. How could she be proud of me and claim to love me while she was in a 6-month relationship with her damn boss? A hint of confusion must have crossed my face because Kelly asked, "What happened, dear?"
"Nothing," I answered. "I was just thinking about the problem."
"Well, stop it. It's a party," Kelly said admonishingly. She barely caught her breath and said, "Hogan, you will never be able to guess what opportunity I was given. Paul and Margaret want me to do some admin work as I plan to go on maternity leave as soon as your job is done. This way, when I leave, there will be no more hanging items. I will work directly for Margaret."
Something in my heart skipped a beat at the thought of Kelly being away from that bastard Paul. A second later, my hopes were dashed. "I'll have to travel sometimes," Kelly continued. "I'll be delivering important papers to Paul during the campaign, so I won't be involved in his campaign, but I'll get to see some of the behind-the-scenes action. This will be so much fun." I felt my heart shatter again. "I know I heard Kelly say she plans to end the affair so we can have a baby, but I can easily imagine her being unfaithful again in anticipation of being on the campaign trail. And if she gets pregnant, who's to say it will be my child? Paul is approximately my size and color. Without a DNA test, this would be very difficult to determine." My rage began to rise, but I suppressed it. Now was not the time. Barbara began talking to Kelly about her new position and the campaign. They soon became engrossed in conversation, and I was forgotten. I took this opportunity to pull myself together. After tonight, I'll start planning. I needed to somehow counteract Paul's political power, but to be honest, I had no idea how to do it. 2 days later, the answer came to my office. "Your meeting for 4 o'clock is already here," my administrator called through the open door. I looked at my Outlook calendar and didn't see anything booked. Before I could answer, she came in. Barbara Evans. "Hey, Hogan," she greeted as she entered. Her long auburn hair flowed over her shoulders. She wore a light sundress that showed off her gorgeous legs and strappy sandals that hugged her legs almost to her knees. Her breasts were modestly covered, with no cleavage, but the material pressed against her chest in a suggestive manner. Two thin straps held up the dress, leaving her arms bare. I was speechless as I watched her enter. "I hope you don't mind," Barbara began. She closed my office door behind her. "I told Mary that we had a meeting to discuss my career and how Kelly was working for my father." I politely rose from my chair. "I'm glad to see you. Just working on some reports." I motioned for her to take one of the chairs in front of my table. After she sat down, I sat down too. "What did you want to talk about?" The happy expression suddenly disappeared from Barbara's face. "I think you know, Bob. I saw it in your face when you talked to my father. I'm really sorry that he's ruining such a good guy." I was stunned. This was not what I expected. "What are you talking about?" I asked carefully. Barbara blacked out. "About this asshole known as my father having an affair with your wife." I sat back in my chair when it was said so bluntly. "Did you find out recently?" Barbara asked softly. I nodded. "I'm really sorry." "How? When did you find out?" I asked. "About 3 months ago," Barbara admitted. "I don't know when it started, but I found out about it in February. One Friday I came home early and they were holding one of their meetings at our house. I was having a late lunch with a school friend, and I popped in to drop off my things, say hello, and leave. Dad asked when I would be home, and I answered that after dinner. It turned out that my friend got sick and couldn't come. I had a snack and went home. There I saw Dad and Kelly having sex in our jacuzzi. I took photos and even filmed them running naked into the house. There was a full foot of snow on the ground." "Did you take pictures of your father having sex?" I asked in shock. I was also wondering if I could get copies of the photos. This would be very helpful in a divorce. As if reading my thoughts, Barbara reached into her bag, pulled out a large envelope, and placed it on my desk. "Here are photographs from that day, and several others." She paused and grinned. "Dad installed a security system in the house. The entire exterior is covered, and several interior rooms have cameras. If you know the site and have the key fob and password, you can access it from almost anywhere. There is a flash drive with video recordings." I was shocked by this. Paul's daughter conveyed to me everything that could be needed to divorce and destroy her father. "Why?" I asked. The sad expression on Barbara's face turned into anger. "Because," she said quietly, "I hate him more than you ever could." I didn't say anything but waited. After a moment, she spoke. "Dad met Mom when she was a college student. He was an aspiring lawyer assigned to the sex crimes unit in Philadelphia. Mom came to study from Ireland. Her family was well off but died in the Londonderry bombing. She came here to get away from the turmoil. Her voice took on a soft note that she probably picked up from her mother. Mom was dating some loser who hit her so hard she ended up in intensive care. Kelly paused and placed a small book on my table. It was quite thick and decorated with greenery and lace. I found her diary after she died, and she was something of a submissive lover. She liked being commanded by a strong man. This idiot went too far, and she ended up in the hospital. My father was entrusted with this task. They met, the asshole went to jail, and a year later, they got married. My father was always ambitious. He got a smart, beautiful woman with an exotic accent. Mom got a strong man who will protect her. I appeared a few years later. Dad wanted me to do gymnastics. He thought a daughter competing in the Olympics would do wonders for his political career. Do you know how the careers of most gymnasts end? Shaking my head, I replied, I never thought about it. Barbara smiled. They call it the three B's, boobs, boobs, butts, butts, and boys, boys. I got the first one. I was told to do cheerleading and be an all-American girl. I didn't mind. I loved performing. But by the age of 16, I realized that I was just a prop for my father's ambitions. Mom knew about this almost from the very beginning. My father had affairs almost from the moment they got married. Mom knew and begged him to stop, but she was too weak to do anything about it. She felt trapped. She was a committed Catholic, so divorce was out of the question. Barbara paused for a moment, and I let her collect her thoughts. After a moment, she continued, "Sometimes I wonder if her poor reaction to cancer treatment was a result of her unconsciously wanting to die or actively sabotaging her treatment. Anyway, I was with her in the hospital when she died. The official story is that my father went to court and won a murder case. He forced the doctor to change the time of death. In fact, he had sex with his assistant in her apartment to celebrate. He simply presented his mother as a trophy, and the press loved the story of how they met. A heroic prosecutor goes to save a beaten woman. Damn, that bastard himself beat her more than once, and I saw it. Why are you telling me all this? I was forced to ask. Because you don't deserve it, Hogan. My father, he's not a very good man. After my mother died, he hid his affairs until I left for college. Then he began to organize meetings in the house, and they're not just for his work. He also hosts meetings for some of the charity groups he is involved with. I know for sure that he sleeps with two other women from these groups. One of the poor women actually thinks this is true love and plans to leave her husband. Is this what Kelly is thinking of doing? I asked. I understood what I had heard, but I was still curious. Barbara shook her head. No, she thinks it's just fun. They say that power is the main aphrodisiac. Kelly seems to be proof of that. I heard her talking to my dad about some senator they were meeting with. So, what do you want? I asked. To her credit, Barbara looked me straight in the eye as she answered, I want you to get out of your marriage with this traitor. I want my father's career to be ruined to the point where he would never be elected dog catcher in a town full of cats. I thought about just sending my material to the newspapers or even to the other party, but he has too many friends. I believe that together we can make them pay. Won't it be more difficult for you to finish school? She tossed her auburn hair again. No, my mother left me her inheritance as a trust fund. I didn't touch it, but if it came down to it, I could pay for the rest of my tuition and MBA and still have a nice cushion left over. If your mother had so much money, why didn't she take you and leave? She could go to Ireland, where your father wouldn't reach. Barbara winced. As I said, she was raised Irish Catholic. She was taught that divorce was not an option. No matter what happened, my mother held on to her faith until the very end. This is the only thing that makes me think that her death was unconscious and not intentional, since they also consider suicide to be the unforgivable sin. I must admit, I could not see anything but the truth in Barbara. She said she wanted to ruin her father's career, and the fact that I had this information did not bode well for his ambitions. I didn't think it could be some kind of trap. If Kelly and Paul wanted to destroy me, they could do it openly in court. This mean shit was only for those who were desperate, like me. A plan began to form in my head. I need Barbara's help with a few things. If nothing else, it would show me how dedicated she was to destroying her father. Okay, I agreed. But I don't want to destroy him by publishing these pictures or even naming him in the divorce. Barbara looked at this in surprise. Why not? She demanded. Her face turned red with passion, and she took a breath to begin some speech. I stopped her with a raised hand. I didn't say we wouldn't destroy him, but I don't want to deal with the bad press of a cuckolded husband in a political scandal. Instead, I want to destroy what he has strived for all his life, destroy his power and influence, and I can have a nice, quiet divorce that no one will worry about. Barbara looked at me with shock on her face. A minute later, a sly smile appeared on her face. What do you want from me? I grinned. I'm going to do what I do best. Get me his financial documents, personal and for his campaign. They took Capone thanks to tax evasion. Having met your father, I have no doubt that I can find something. And if not... What? She asked. I smiled. I can do one more thing. For the next 3 days, Barbara and I were busy. She installed a keystroke recorder on her father's personal laptop and home computer. She also took a full backup of his computer's hard drive. We configured their security system to upload records to a cloud space known to me, which was physically located abroad. For my part, I didn't listen to Kelly's phone. Thanks to Barbara's evidence, I didn't need anything else. I activated a GPS tracker designed for parents keeping an eye on their children. Basically, it just used cell towers to determine the location unless I sent a command to activate the GPS. I just didn't want her to find me at home while I was busy with work. I faked a groin injury the day after Barbara first came to see me. This gave me an excuse not to have sex with my wife. After learning about the number of Paul's partners, I didn't want to take any more risks than I already unknowingly took. Plus, I don't think I could have done it without my anger exploding. By the way, I made an appointment with the doctor to get tested for sexually transmitted diseases. Nothing was detected at first, but some, like HIV, can take months to test positive for antibodies. Kelly went to the conference in Pittsburgh for her last date with Paul, annoyed and upset. No wonder she was very excited about the trip. My problem was that somewhere inside, I still loved her. I will never be able to trust her again, but that doesn't mean I don't still love her. But I also couldn't bear the thought of having sex with her after what I found out. It was Thursday morning, and Kelly, her bag packed, was waiting for Paul and the junior lawyer from their office who was traveling with them to the conference. I wonder if the young guy knew he was their cover. So, I'll be home Sunday afternoon, Kelly said, coming up to me after dropping her bag at the front door. I sat at the table with my back to her and sipped my coffee. She wrapped her arms around me and leaned down until her lips were next to my ear. I hope you feel better so we can start taking care of the baby, she whispered. Her tone would raise the dead, and her scent. It took me back to more innocent days. I wanted to cry right there, but I managed to restrain myself. I'll apply ice to help it heal, I assured her. I stroked her hand and kissed her forehead. Hmm, she moaned. I wish I didn't have to go there. It would be so much better to just stay home with you and be naked all weekend. You can always tell Evans that something more important has come up, I said. It just came out. And by the way she looked at me, she heard something in my tone. What's your problem with Paul? She asked in amazement. First you were rude at the party, and now you talk like you hate this person. I forced myself to calm down and shrugged. Honestly, I've seen too many hot-headed jerks like Evans who think he's untouchable and the epitome of power. They are a big fish in a small pond. They sell the illusion of power and force people to buy into it. Like that mayor in South Carolina last year. A big, influential guy embezzled the city's money while sleeping with 3 married women. Now he's serving 10 years in federal prison, and they're all divorced and publicly humiliated. I get the same feeling from Evans. If he gets to Washington within a week, he'll be seducing clueless interns. But eventually, the wheels of his car will fall off. And when that happens, I wouldn't want a hotel somewhere nearby. Kelly looked at me in shock. She'd heard me rant about those bastards before, but I'd never associated Evans with them before. I probably should have kept my mouth shut, but it felt good to let it out. And although the marriage was over, I also felt it was only fair to warn Kelly. I still loved her, even if I would never trust her again. Hogan, that's terrible what you said about Paul, Kelly protested. He is a good person who has done a lot for the people of this district. He's not like that. I heard an almost pleading tone in her denial. At a time that could not have been predicted, we heard the sound of a car horn outside the house. Paul has arrived. Kelly let out a frustrated sigh. She gave me a look that quickly turned into a mixture of regret and fear. I'll be home in 4 days, Kelly said, conciliatory. We can talk about it then. But get ready, love. We have a child to start with. Then she wrapped her arms around me and kissed me passionately. I responded with an equally passionate kiss. Have a nice week, she breathed. I love you. I love you too, I replied. She grabbed her bag and opened the front door. Bye, dear, she called over her shoulder. Goodbye, Kelly, I said. Then I closed the door. 30 minutes later, I left by train for the city. Barbara and I had an appointment with the FBI. It turned out that I did not need to prepare any evidence. I would rate Paul Evans's embezzlement skills as moderately smart. Barbara and I met at her off-campus apartment to review the documents she had pulled from his computer. Overall, pretty standard methods. I estimate he had about $2 million stashed away in an offshore account. At least that's what he transferred to it, but I couldn't be sure it was still there because those records weren't included. Much of this money came from various small donors who wouldn't raise suspicion from the IRS, but why were people from out of state donating to the DA's campaign? I was able to trace some of them to defendants whose cases were dismissed or entered into plea agreements with unusually lenient sentences. It was Barbara who found the biggest bomb. It turned out that she was not the only child. Along the way, Evans knocked up two more women. One of them was born 3 years before the death of his wife. His mother was one of his employees at the time. The third child, born 8 months after his wife's death, was born to an 18-year-old volunteer at the hospital where his wife was being treated. Evans gave each woman $2,000 a month in campaign contributions as poll research consultants. Barbara almost destroyed her own apartment in anger. That red hair really is a warning. By the time Kelly and Paul left, we had already checked everything in Paul's notes. Questions remained, but we did not have enough resources to get to the information. So I wrote down all my findings and set up a meeting with the senior FBI agent I worked with in the Philadelphia office. Barbara came to tell him the story we had made up. Barbara said that after taking a forensic accounting course, she wanted to look at real documents. She decided to look at her father's notes out of innocent curiosity. When she noticed some strange things, she called me because my wife worked for her father and knew about my experience. Gary was a seasoned professional. He knew there was more to it, but we dropped a gift-wrapped gift in his lap, so he didn't press the issue. Dirty prosecutor in his own backyard? A dirty prosecutor who just launched a campaign for the U.S. Senate. This career-making thing feels like manna from heaven. We caught a taxi to Barbara's apartment since she had a late class, and I walked to the 30th Street station to catch the train home. I thought about packing my things and leaving when Kelly got home. Gary promised to expedite the case to at least subpoena Evans' documents by Wednesday. It is unlikely that much time will pass before word of the investigation becomes known. The bastard will find out how illusory his power is when all the rats leave his ship. Kelly called me while I was on the train home. She said she called early because they were going to have some big dinner and it would be very late before she got back to her room. I had no doubt that tonight she didn't plan to stay in her room at all. I made some vague remarks, saying that everything was fine. She caught my distracted tone and asked what was the matter. I just had a meeting with some FBI agents about something, I replied. I'm in the carriage, and besides, the investigation is still ongoing, so I can't talk about it. All this was completely true. It looks like it really got to you, Kelly said worriedly. Yes, this case will be terrible. It might become national news when the full story leaks. Is it true? Kelly asked, looking a little intrigued. Can you give me a little hint? I couldn't resist. Corrupt politicians, bribes, money laundering, sex, adultery, children. Any of my friends? He darkened her. I've already said too much. If I say anything else, the Bureau will shut me down. Oh, you're no fun, Kelly pouted. Don't worry, love, your secret is safe with me. We said goodbye, and she switched off. When I entered the house, it all just amazed me. My marriage was over. We dated and were married. We were together for 10 years. I never expected to be single again, but now that's exactly what I was about to do. In the end, I just sat on the couch and waited for the sun to set. I just sat and watched. I felt like I was watching my life sink into the horizon. I was just watching. It was many hours after sunset before I moved again. It was midday on Saturday when I came out of my self-pitying fit. I won't say I didn't deserve some slack, but I knew I needed to shake things up. Ironically, I was mowing the lawn again when I saw a BMW convertible pull into my driveway. I stopped the mower and watched Barbara get out of the car. The first thing I saw was her long, pale legs sticking out from the driver's side. She was again wearing sandals with thin cords that wrapped around her calves. They always made me think of the ancient Greeks. As she stepped out, I saw her sculpted legs flex, indicating strength beneath her firm flesh. In keeping with the Greek trend, she wore a pure white toga-like dress that ended mid-thigh, but with 5 centimeters of lace at the bottom, allowing her upper thighs to be seen. The dress was made of a light, silky material that hugged her curves and tended to be semi-sheer. Her perky breasts were supported by a bikini top that was visible through the dress. Her arms were free of everything except the light freckles that dotted her skin on her upper arms and shoulders. The dress only went down one shoulder, leaving the other bare. Long red hair fell in waves onto the same shoulders. However, it was her gray-green eyes and smile that caught my attention as she approached me. I turned off the engine and greeted her. "Well, you look better than I expected," Barbara said. "I half expected to have to take you out of the bottle or off the ledge." I snorted. Last night I had a lot of thoughts about both options. "We had to do this," I said. "Besides, it distracts me." "Have you met with a lawyer?" she asked. I shrugged. "I did it on Tuesday before they left. The documents will be ready on Monday. I agreed to audit a client in Austin and leave on Tuesday. Usually I spend 3 days on such business trips and then work remotely until I complete the report. In this case, I will be there for all 3 weeks." I shrugged again. "This is probably a coward's way out, but I don't want to be here when all this mess starts brewing." I saw agreement on Barbara's face. She knew that this would draw attention to her as the daughter of this bastard. "Well, I'm glad you're thinking ahead," the redhead said. "But I realize that this is what you are good at." That smile again. "Now I can plan too." "Okay, here's my plan," Barbara announced. "I'll help you finish your work here, and then you'll come to me. We'll have fun, and you'll even be able to look at me crazy. I have a swimsuit that you will absolutely love." I tried to perk up. "Barbara, I'm still married," I protested, "and I don't think I'll be ready for anything for a while." "You need to let off some steam before you explode," the sexy redhead insisted. "Besides, you know the old saying, what's good for the goose is good for the goose." Her gaze was playful, sly, and artless at the same time. I couldn't help but laugh. In one of those bizarre coincidences that proves that truth is stranger than fiction, we ran into Olivia. After finishing my yard work, I cleaned up and we went for a late lunch at a nice restaurant. I wasn't in the mood for revenge sex, but it was nice to get out of the house, and going somewhere with such a sweet girl like Barbara was not at all difficult. As I approached the restaurant, I noticed that a car was parked outside. It was Oliva's car. I almost told Barbara to turn around and we could find another place, but I didn't. Instead, I did something that was completely out of character for me. It was all on a whim. After all my careful planning, something just snapped inside me when I saw Olivia's car parked in that lot. I casually hugged the red-haired beauty and led her into the restaurant without further ado. There I gave the owner a tip so that he could seat us at a certain table. It was somewhat obscured, but was visible when returning from the toilet. I sat Barbara down facing outwards and sat down next to her. She smiled when I took her hand. "Why did it happen?" She smiled sweetly. "Not that I'm complaining," I laughed. "Do you remember I told you about how I found out about my wife's betrayal? About her friend Olivia? So her car is parked right on the street." Barbara burst into throaty laughter. "So I can be the other woman? Ooh, I can live with that." She leaned forward and kissed me incredibly softly on the lips. It was not a deep, passionate kiss, but rather a kiss that hinted and promised much more. A lover's kiss. Our dishes arrived, and I frankly enjoyed myself. The tricks were forgotten as I enjoyed Barbara's company. Her witty sense of humor was killing me. I've never heard a counting sound so dirty before. I happened to look back and noticed Olivia walking past us. I pointed it out to Barbara. "Oh my God," she giggled. I was so looking forward to this. With that, she leaned forward to kiss me. I felt my hand reach under the table and rest on her leg. The skin of her thighs was so incredibly soft, and underneath were firm, elastic muscles. The touch was electric. I was so lost in the sensation that I was surprised when I heard Olivia screaming at me. "Hogan, what the hell are you doing?" she shouted at me. "Who is this tramp? Running away from your wife while she's out of town? I thought better of you. I have no doubt that the entire restaurant heard her." I let go of Barbara and turned to look at my ex-girlfriend. "What's your problem, Liv? It's just a little carefree sex before Kelly and I settle down and have a baby. And could you keep it down? People are trying to eat." Olivia stared at me as if I had hit her with a dead fish. "What?" she began. "Oh, come on, Liv. Kelly does the same. I'm sure she's having fun with her boss right now, and for several months now. So I decided it was only fair that I seduce the boss's daughter. I think..." Olivia almost had a heart attack. Feeling Barbara start to giggle, I gave her a gentle squeeze to keep her quiet. "You know about..." Olivia stuttered. "I know that I must be a faithful, ignorant husband while my wife runs around being so ably helped by a woman whom I considered my close friend." Olivia winced at the contempt in my voice. "I know Kelly wanted to try something else one last time before having a baby. Like that last fling before the wedding, if it was normal for her, what do you have against me? I had no information about Kelly having affairs before Paul, but as they say, once changed, always changed." I shot my suspicion into the darkness and wondered if Live was off balance enough to confirm it. She confirmed. "Do you know about this too?" She sighed. "No, but thanks for the confirmation," I replied. Olivia turned pale at this. "Go away, Olivia," I said. She turned and ran away from the table. A few minutes later, we heard a noise. It was Olivia leaving the restaurant. "Well, it was fun while it lasted," Barbara said with a slight laugh. "I really wanted her to stay here longer." Her smile made me blush. "You know she's probably on the phone with your wife right now," she added. "Perhaps," I agreed. "I give her 5 minutes before my phone goes off. However, if she left right now, it would be a 5-hour drive home from Pittsburgh. This will give us time for dessert and give me enough time to drive home and pack my things. It's a pity that I won't see you in a bikini like you promised." Barbara laughed again. "Oh, I guess we can do this another time." She reached out to grab my shirt and pull me closer. "You know, my semester ends in a week and a half," she muttered in my ear. I always wanted to see Austin. I barely caught her words as her tongue slipped into my ear. Kelly started calling me 10 minutes after Olivia left the restaurant. I listened to a few of her messages, and she was furious that I cheated on her. This almost made me laugh. After an hour of her messages and texts, I blocked her number. I knew she would eventually just call from another phone, but she was driving back from Pittsburgh, so she couldn't just ask to borrow someone's phone on the highway. When I got home, I packed all my personal belongings, not just my stuff, for the trip to Austin. I had time. 4 hours after meeting Olivia, I was leaving my home for what might be the last time. After booking a hotel room near the Philadelphia airport, I put most of my belongings in storage until I found a place to stay. I talked to Barbara on the phone several times. She was walking with a friend because her father was now leaving furious messages on her phone. I moved my flight to Austin a day and left on Monday morning. Kelly managed to call my phone several times from other numbers. Now it was a tearful rant about how I could do this to her, why I ruined her career, etc., and so on. Obviously, Olivia's initial screams attracted the attention of many people. Then, someone posted a pretty accurate comment on their blog and called Barbara and I gamers. My comment about Kelly having fun with Paul was also posted along with the fact that they were together in Pittsburgh over the weekend. This caused quite a stir in the county's political circles and at the courthouse. For the rest of the week, I avoided most news from Philadelphia. It wasn't until Friday that I received a letter telling me what was going on in Doylestown. Surprisingly, it was a letter from Margaret, a senior manager in the DA's office. The elderly lawyer apologized for everything that happened. She knew that Paul had been seeing two women outside the office, but she knew nothing about Kelly's involvement. She also praised me for taking revenge by using the law against the lawyer. It was an eventful week in DA Buck's office, Margaret said. Paul was in the office Monday morning trying to deal with the fallout and denying any inappropriate behavior on his part. This is just my daughter's rebellion under the influence of her cheating husband, was the story he was trying to sell. Then on Tuesday, Kelly was served with divorce papers on the grounds of adultery. The envelope contained photographs, DVDs, and a letter from me. Kelly's scream of horror when she read my letter caused Margaret and two other people to run into her office. Kelly fell into a chair in shock, and Margaret noticed the photographs that had fallen out onto the table. In my letter to Kelly, I told her that I was not having an affair, but hoped that she now had an idea of how I felt about her and this jerk. I told her I couldn't be married to someone I couldn't trust, especially now that I knew she'd been unfaithful before. There was little activity at the DA's office Tuesday. The next day, Margaret was in Paul's office for a meeting when four men in suits suddenly walked in. Paul yelled at them for interrupting an important meeting when one of the men told Paul that he was under arrest. She said he was in complete shock when he was handcuffed and taken out of the office. They led him right out the front door of the courthouse and past reporters who had somehow been alerted. I owe Gary a few beers for this. At the end of her letter, Margaret apologized for allowing them to behave this way in her office. She also asked me to let her know if I needed anything because I didn't deserve this kind of behavior. I'm sure part of her letter was about damage control, but mostly I think Margaret was the moral and professional person I always took her to be. Now all my plans for a quiet divorce have gone to hell because of my own stupid, impulsive prank with Olivia in that restaurant. Philadelphia news stations quickly learned of Paul's arrest and charges against him. As I told Kelly, this story had all the makings of a summer romance. Sex, betrayal, revenge, and too much anger. The news media loved it, and it was quickly picked up by Hungry 24 news outlets. I avoided the worst because I was out of town, and they were unable to track me down because I had booked a second hotel room 10 miles away from the one on my work itinerary. However, I checked in there, and reporters were stationed around it, trying to catch me. I saw on TV that they were camped in front of my house. Kelly didn't come out, and they only filmed my relatives coming in and out. Barbara had it the worst of all. She was the daughter who betrayed her own father. She still had to go to classes and take exams, so for the first few days, it was quite easy for the media to find her. The school then forced the reporters to leave campus because they were disturbing students. It also helped that two women who had children with Paul came forward to get their 15 minutes of fame. With her final finale complete, Barbara slipped out of campus and headed to the airport. The media were disappointed, but not too surprised, when she didn't show up for the graduation ceremony. After a while, this story became a side news story and stayed there. It boiled over when Paul's trial began, but he pleaded guilty to several charges, resulting in him becoming a 20-year-old guest of the federal government. Fortunately, his guilty plea meant that Barbara and I were not called to testify. Then, the case completely disappeared from their radar, taking Barbara, Kelly, and me with it. Oddly enough, after all this publicity, my divorce went quickly and with minimal fuss. Kelly signed the papers 4 days after receiving them. I received a letter apologizing for what she did to me and to us. Furious, returning from Pittsburgh, she swore that she would never forgive me for betraying me. Finding out that she was, in fact, the only one cheating, made her realize how hypocritical she had been. She accepted my offer of a 50-50 split and simply asked that at some point, when things weren't so rough, I would agree to meet with her so she could apologize in person. At the end, she said that she would always love me and wished me well. I later learned from her mother that she had quit her job and moved to the Midwest to live with her aunt. Finding Paul did wonders for my career. In the press, the FBI gave me full credit for analyzing Paul's tapes. Since I was hiding from the same press, I was even more thorough in my work in Austin and found not only the embezzler they were looking for, but also a second one, about whom, at that time, they had no information. My firm promoted me and put me in charge of the white-collar crime team. And yes, some joker labeled the team Hogan's Heroes. But the best part was when they assigned me an assistant, recent college graduate wishing to gain experience in forensic accounting. I've never enjoyed working late so much. And this bikini looked even better on the floor of my hotel room. Subscribe to our channel so that your second chaff doesn't cheat on you, and go ahead and listen to the next story, because this story is nothing compared to the next one. If you're under 18, don't even think about listening to the next one. 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 Listening to the next one.